Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlilhu fala hadiya lahu. Wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa nashhadu anna sayyidana wa maulana Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu. صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأهل بيته وأزواجه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا وإن الله على نصرهم لقدير صدق الله العظيم قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم لا عيش إلا عيش الآخرة فَغْفِرْ لِلْأَنصَارَ وَالْمُهَاجِرَةِ او كما قال نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected brothers and elders, I've got a slight cough which has been with me for the past 3 weeks. So if I cough in between, please excuse me. If you followed the previous two bayans, and some of you might have and some of you haven't, you know that the periods that have been covered were, firstly, the Makkah period. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, or we can say the life of Islam, for 13 years in Makkah. After that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the permission to migrate to Madinah. And Mufti Atiq last week discussed the migration to Madinah. Now, my job today, inshallah, is to discuss the Madinah period. Now, between the two periods of Makkah and Madinah, to understand how the two different periods were different, all we need to do is open the Quran. If you open the Quran, you'd see, by analyzing the surahs or the verses of the Quran, or the chapters of the Quran, that you'll see that the Makkah surahs were very short, very brief, and they concentrated on building the iman of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So they were very brief, emotional statements. The verses of the Quran are like that in the Makkah period, the verses that were revealed in Makkah. On contrast, if you look at the Madinah period and the verses that were revealed in Madinah, they are long and they are very detailed. So in brief, the Makkah period was to build the iman and to build the hearts of the Muslims. The Madinah period, simply speaking, was to build the Islamic state. So once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had made a group of followers, he needed a base to complete his mission and to build a Muslim state, a Muslim identity where they can work from. Makkah was too hostile. The Quraysh were too hostile against the Muslims, so they couldn't make a base there. So the order was given by Allah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was shown in a dream that he's going to migrate to Medina. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after migrating to Medina, there were some steps that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to take to ensure the future of the Islamic state or the Islamic nation. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came to Medina, he was faced with troubles. Because why? He had left Makkah behind. All the belongings, all the wealth, all the prosperity that the Muslims had in Makkah, they did hijrat and they left everything behind and they came to Medina. Now in Medina, they were homeless. They didn't have money. They didn't have trade. They hardly had anything. There were three groups of people when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina that he was faced with in Medina. Number one were the companions. Amongst the companions, there were two groups. the people who were the Ansar, the helpers in Medina, and the second group was the Al-Muhajirun, the people who migrated from Makkah to Medina. Now you can imagine, the only bond between these people was Islam. The only bond between the Muhajirun and Ansar was Islam. So this bond had to be worked upon. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to go to great lengths to actually make this bond solid. Amongst the Ansar, there were two tribes, Al-Aus and Al-Khazraj. Also, amongst them, they were battling, feuding, disputing all the time. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Medina, they were on the brink of feeling a pact. And they were about to make a leader from amongst themselves who became the Ra'isul Munafiqeen, or the leader of the Munafiqs, Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Salul. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina, the Aus and Khazraj, because of their infighting, they said, we need to call a truce. And this person was the most prominent amongst them, Abdullah ibn Ubay. So they decided to make him the leader, the king. So you can imagine, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, his kingship was taken away. Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Salul's kingship was taken away, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was to become the new leader. So Aus and Khazraj, the two groups of the Ansar, they didn't make him the leader, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became the leader of the Muslims as he came there. So now the Aus and Khazraj, the dispute was stopped, not through Ubaydullah ibn Salul, who became the Munafiq, a traitor, a hypocrite, openly declaring Islam, but inside he was with the Jews and against Islam. So the first group the Prophet ﷺ had to put together and combine them with the Aus and Khazraj, they were combined. Another enemy came out from there was the Munafiq. Now I will talk in more detail later about how the Prophet ﷺ combined the two groups. The second group of people were the non-Muslims in Medina. The Ansars in Medina who weren't Muslims, these people were also split into two groups. One group was their previous beliefs that they had, the pagan beliefs that they had, was not strong and firm. So they were in doubt. When Islam came, they thought, this seems good. So they were against Islam and they were for Islam. The other group that I've mentioned already is the Munafiqs, the hypocrites, or those people who were against Islam. Initially, they didn't declare the Islam, but as Islam started getting stronger, they declared themselves to be Muslims, but behind the scenes, وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا. When they met the believers, they said, آمَنَّا, we believe you. We believe in Allah. وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. But when they met with their mates, meaning the Jews, the Jewish leaders, what they did, they said, we with you, don't worry. We're just messing around, taking a mick out of these guys. They think we're with them, but really we're with you. So the Jews, the Munafiqs was the second group that were amongst the non-believers. People who were on the verge of accepting, and people who were not going to accept. They accepted, but they were actually lying. So this was the second group of people that the Prophet ﷺ had to deal with. Then we have the third group of people who were the Jews of Medina. These Jews had actually, when they were persecuted in Syria, they had moved from there, and they had, by the Byzantines, they had moved from Syria and that region, and they've come and settled in Medina. Now their dress code and their behavior became like the Arabs. So they spoke the Arabic language, they dressed like the Arabs. There were some intermarriages. They married amongst the Arabs, but they still kept to their faith of Judaism. Even though they were not practicing Jews, but they still believed that they were Jews. They were mostly involved in witchcraft and obviously the main thing that they were doing was making money. Making money with usury. Abusing people to make money. So this is what they were doing in Medina. So the three groups of people that the Prophet ﷺ was met with, one were the Muslims, amongst them the Muhajirun and the Ansar. The second group were the non-believers, non-believing Arabs, two groups of them. One on verge of becoming Muslim and the other one were not going to accept. And the third group were the Jews. So there was a big muddle of people here, which the Prophet ﷺ had to come and win their hearts and make sure that the Islamic State can function there together. So now this was the state of the people in Medina. The Prophet ﷺ, to fulfill his mission, did three things in Medina. Now, because obviously the Medina period is long, I'm not going to go into detail of everything and tell you what exactly happened. But in brief, I will tell you what happened was, the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina. The first thing that the Prophet ﷺ did was to build a masjid. You know, in the migration when he came, the Prophet ﷺ came and settled in Quba. He stayed in Quba for a few days, built a masjid there at that time. The first masjid. لَمَسْجِدٌ أُسِّسْ عَلَى التَّقْوَى مِنْ أَوَّلِ يَوْمٍ أَحَقُّ أَنْ تَقُومَ فِيهِ. The masjid built on taqwa, as the Quran says. So he stayed for a few days in Masjid al-Quba. After that, he decided to enter Medina. This was on the outskirts. So as he entered Medina, he left his camel. He was riding on his she camel, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Sahaba, they were very keen and they were eager to take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to their house. You know, such an honorable guest to have. So what they did, they were holding the rein of his camel to try and take him, but the camel was not moving in any direction. The Prophet ﷺ said that, leave the camel be, let her be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a destination for her to go, and she will stop there. So what happened? The camel went through the streets of Medina, and where the Masjid al-Nabawi is now, this is where the camel went and knelt down. And this was opposite the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he took the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he stayed at that house. Now where the camel had stopped was a mirbad. Mirbad meaning a place where dates were dried. So this mirbad or this place belonged to two orphans from amongst the Ansar. So he summoned these two orphans and he said, I want to purchase this land from you. So obviously, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking, they said, no, Messenger of Allah, you can take it for free. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, I'm not going to take it for free. So what he did, he purchased the land from these two people for 10 dinars. And according to some people, some narrations, he said that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he paid these 10 dinars on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this land was purchased, even though he could have taken it for free. Now imagine if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taken it for free. To this day, everyone would have said that he came and robbed the orphans. So the wisdom behind that was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never took it. He paid for it. And this is something that we should do as well. You know, as people, we sometimes think that, you know, you might have some position, some standing, some status in the society. And we think, okay, you know, because I've got a position, I've got a standing, I can take things for free. Yeah? I can abuse. This is totally wrong. Islamically, it's totally wrong. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could have easily taken the land of the orphans. They were giving it voluntarily. The leader of the Muslim nation wants a piece of land. Who wouldn't donate it? Charity. Sadaqah. You can donate it. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, I'm going to buy it of you. And he did buy it of them. So these qualities we need to instill in ourselves, that we should work and we should do things. When you take something, you pay for it. Yeah? If you go to a garage and they say to you, Molvi Sab, you know, okay, you're a Molvi, I'll let you off. You should say, no, I'm okay. Don't look at me, I'll pay you my full money that you need. In the same way, if you come to me for something, I'll take full money of you as well. Yeah? So in that way, when you go somewhere, you should also put that in your character. Because what happens? If you do that, then the the system works. If you start cutting corners and taking money from, he'll take less money from me, but then he'll say, oh no, I've lost some money from this guy because he's a Mulvi. So what I'll do is, I'll charge the next person a bit more. So we don't want that in society. We want the society to be clean. So if you've taken a job from someone, you pay him. At the end of the day, you know, something happens and then he lets you off, but fair enough. But try to be as clear in your transactions as possible, like the Prophet ﷺ did when he came to Medina. So now, there were graves of some mushrikeen, idol worshippers, in the actual area. So the Prophet ﷺ asked for these graves to be dug and taken to another place. There were trees, and these trees were cut down. And then the mosque was made. It was about 100 meters or so square. Yeah? So it wasn't huge, but it was made in a simple way with unbaked stones. Yeah? So the masjid was simple. Very simple. Not like the masjid that we see nowadays. You go into the mosque and you feel like you've entered a palace. When you go to the mosque, and you're in namaz, you go to some mosque and you see the decoration, your mind is on the decorations. That is such a beautiful mosque. You're not talking about Allah. You're looking at the decoration, how wonderful it is. The reality is, we as Muslims should not make our mosque so extravagant like that. It should be simple. You can make them strong and nice, but if you make them so extravagant, think of it logically. The reason why we come to the mosque is to what? To make a connection with Allah and to leave the dunya behind. Yeah? But if you come into the mosque and you see all these riches and all this beauty and all these gold-plated walls and all these decorations, you think you're more inclined to the dunya. You go into the mosque to be disinclined to the dunya. You leave the mosque saying, no, I want to attain wealth so that I can have this as well. So, mosque should be simple, but this is going off the subject now. Now the Prophet ﷺ made the simple mosque. The masjid was made. The main reason why the Prophet ﷺ made the masjid straight away was, think of it. Everyone must have had tried to organize meetings. Yeah? Everyone works, they have jobs. Have you tried to organize a meeting? Say there's a society or a committee that wants to get a meeting. How long does it take? It takes time. You'll send text out and say, are you free on this date? Half of them will say we're free. Half of them will not reply. Some of them will say that I can't make it. So to organize a meeting, it's difficult, isn't it? It takes time. It's difficult. So the masjid is a blessed place. Because what will happen in the masjid is that you have to come for 5 times prayer. You have to come to namaz 5 times a day. So the meeting is already being called 5 times a day for the Muslims to gather. This is why we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to stress so much and emphasize so much of coming to the masjid for jamaat. Why? Because this is the gathering place of the Muslims where you can see, okay, this person is well, this person is ill, he hasn't come, is there something wrong with him? Shall we go and see? This person's come, he looks sad. Let's ask him how he is. So all these interaction that you see in the masjid is actually, we don't come to the masjid just to worship and then go. We actually come to see that what are the rest of the Muslims in our community doing? Are they good? Are they well? Are they bad? If we need to say something, then easily to get the message out to them at that time. Yeah? That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in a hadith that I would order someone to start the jamaat, and I will go to the houses of those people who haven't come to the masjid, and I will burn the houses. Imagine the rahmatul lil alameen, the mercy for the worlds. He is saying that I'm going to go out for people who are not coming to the masjid for jamaat. I'm going to go and burn their houses. Why? What's the reason behind it? They can do ibadat at home, can't they? It's a bigger picture. The picture is, if they come, then we know what's happening in the Muslim society. We can look after each other. Yeah? This is, it's so beautiful how Islam works. You come to the masjid 5 times a day. Then, if it's a big city, then you have some masajid which are known as the Jami Masjid. Yeah? In which Jummah takes place. Because they had literally masjids everywhere, in which Jummah never used to take place. Or some masjids are known as the Jami Masjid, in which the Jummah takes place. Obviously here, all masjids take Jummah, have Jummah in them. But usually in Medina, all the masajid did not have Jummah in them. So all the Sahabas used to gather in the bigger mosques, or in the Masjid al-Nabawi, to perform Jummah. So then you know what's happening in all the localities of your town. So you take, for example, in Oldham, if you had one big mosque here, in a place, one big mosque, everyone went and did Jummah there, then you'll meet everyone else from all corners of Oldham. So this will make people come together more. Then we have the Eid prayers. What happens in Eid prayers? Usually the Eid prayers never used to take place in masjids. They used to take place in big fields, Eidgahs. And what the point was, to gather everyone again together. And then the biggest gathering of Muslims, to see what the Muslims of the whole world are doing. Where is it? Hajj. When you go for Hajj, what happens? You get Chinese, Indonesians, Filipinos, Australians, all the Muslims from all over the world, they gather. The point of that is also not just to worship. It is to worship. But when the Muslims gather from all around the world, you know, okay, how come the Chinese Muslims haven't come this year? Is there something happening in China? Communication is quite fast now, but imagine 200 years ago. Suddenly a nation hasn't come. You think, oh, is there something happening in that nation? Are the Muslims being oppressed there? Can't they come? So it was a big gathering to see how the Muslims are doing. So the mosque was built for this main purpose. So after the mosque was established, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now he had to get the Muslims together. Now the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the Muslims together was, we have one code, and that code is the Quran and the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So once everyone has accepted that, whatever they say, you have to accept. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna akramakum 'indallahi atqakum." The most honorable amongst you is that person who is the most God-fearing. Yeah? لا فرق بين عجمي ولا عربي إلا بالتقوى. There is no difference between the Ajam and the Arab, with the exception of taqwa. So if you want to judge someone who's better and who's worse, it's taqwa. So equality, the Ansar and the Muhajirun. You are all equal. The only thing that will make you better than another person is your piety. This is why, see, in the many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, Al-Muslimuna ka rajulin wahid. The Muslims are like one person, one body. In ishtaka aynuhu ishtaka kullu, wa in ishtaka ra'su ishtaka kullu. That if his eye hurts, then his body will be in pain. Also, if his head hurts, then his body will be in pain. So basically, you're like one person. So you need to look after one another. Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi. Muslim are those people from whose hands and other Muslims and tongue other Muslims stay safe from. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, many ahadiths you can see that to give preference to your brother, give preference to your Muslim brother, your neighbors, give preference to them. So all this community building, you see so many ahadiths. La yu'minu ahadukum hatta yuhibba li akhihi ma yuhibbu li nafsi. Someone will not become a true believer until he doesn't love for his brother what he loves for himself. So if I want something for myself, I should want that for my Muslim brother as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized this, and he drilled that into their minds and hearts to such an extent that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first came to Medina, anyone know about inheritance, miras? When someone dies, say someone's father dies, then the children inherit, yeah, or the brothers inherit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to such an extent that between the Ansar and Muhajirun, Anas ibn Malik says 90 Sahabas, 45 Ansar, 45 Muhajirun were gathered in his house. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you are like brothers now, the fraternity, brothers. So the blood relation that you have with your own brother is not as strong as the Islamic relation that you have. to that extent that the Prophet ﷺ said that even in inheritance, inheriting people, if the Prophet ﷺ made an Ansar and a Muhajir brothers, they would actually inherit from each other if one died. Look at the wisdom behind it. The Muhajirun came with nothing. They came with nothing, didn't they? Making the Ansar the brothers of a Muhajir. So like Abdul Rahman ibn Auf was teamed up or brothered with I can't remember his name. A Sahabi, a Muhajir Sahabi. He was the richest Ansari Sahabi. And when the Prophet ﷺ put them together as brothers, Sa'ad radiallahu ta'ala, he said to Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, the Muhajir, he said that I'm the richest person in Medina. I'll split my wealth into half and give it to you. I've got two wives. I'll divorce one wife and you can have the second, you can have after her in that period. So you can imagine, it was not just a verbal thing that we are brothers, innamal muslimuna, innamal mu'minuna ikhwa, the Muslims are brothers, the believers are brothers. No, in practice the Prophet ﷺ made it such that they were inheriting from each other, they were asked to give the wealth and, you know, divide things physically. Why? Again, building of the community. Because the Muhajirin, the people who migrated, they didn't have anything when they came to Medina. So to make them wanted in Medina and also to build the community, the Prophet ﷺ did this. So this miras or inheriting from one another stayed until the battle of Badr. That's about 2 years. Until the battle of Badr, someone died and the Prophet ﷺ had made them brothers in Islam, then they would inherit from each other. After this, after 2 years in the battle of Badr, وَأُولُ الْأَرْحَامِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلَى بِبَعْضٍ, the kinship overtook and this was abrogated. This was taken out. Okay? So you'll inherit from your brother and your parents. Blood relations will inherit. Why? Because initially when the Prophet ﷺ went to Medina, we need to build a state. So this is the only way to make it stronger, was to make the Islamic brotherhood stronger than the normal brotherhood. So, the brotherhood between the Muslims was made very strong. The third thing that the Prophet ﷺ did when he went to Medina was dealing with the non-Muslims and dealing with the Jews, because the Jews were in Medina. So what the Prophet ﷺ did here was, he made a constitution. And in the constitution, it was written how the Prophet ﷺ dealt, or how the Muslims dealt with each other. Secondly, how the Muslims dealt with the non-Muslims. Okay? So a constitution was written. Now I'm not going to go into the constitution because I can tell the kids are getting agitated here already, because they're thinking this guy's meant to be telling stories, not telling me how a constitution works. Okay? So, have you got a picture? What happened when the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina? He faced a group of three different types of people. He had to deal with these three different types of people. Number one, he built the mosque. Number two, he made the brotherhood between the Muslims, the Ansar and Muhajirun, stronger. And number three, he made a treaty, written treaty, it was like a constitution, which dealt how Muslims should behave with Muslims and how Muslims should behave with their neighbors. So Jews, through this treaty, the Jews were under the protection of the Prophet ﷺ. So if anyone was to attack the Jews, then the Muslims would have to go in their aid. The Jews were given the right to practice their religion freely. They could practice their religion freely, as long as they stayed within the bounds of the treaty. But as usual, you know, the hatred in them didn't allow that. And they broke the treaties, and then slowly, they had three tribes, Banu Qaynuqa, Banu Nadir, and Banu Qurayza. Banu Qaynuqa was the first people that were expelled. And then Banu Nadir and Banu Qurayza, they were also expelled until Khaybar was the last extent where they were totally kicked out. Right? So because why? Not because Islam wanted to take them out, it's because they broke the treaties. Yeah? The treaty of Banu Qaynuqa was broken. Why? It's because what happened was, I'll discuss the Battle of Badr, but what happened after the Battle of Badr, they saw that the Muslims were gaining power. Yeah? So they became very jealous. The Banu Qaynuqa, a tribe of the of the Jews, they became very jealous. So what the Prophet what they did was, there was a jeweler in the market, and a Muslim woman went to sell something to him. So what they did, they told her, oh, remove the face veil. We want to see your face. They started messing around with her. So she didn't do it. So what they did, they tied something to her cloth, to her clothes. So when she tried to get up and leave, it revealed her body. So when a Muslim was passing by, he saw that, he came and beat the Jew up. Yeah? By hitting the Jew died. Then the Jew killed someone else, and then the treaty was broken. Basically, they violated the rights of the Muslim. So a Muslim woman was violated. So that's why the treaty was broken, and they were forced to leave their homes. Right? Initially. And then the 7th of Hijri, after Hijri, the rest of them were expelled. But we're not going to go into detail with that. Now, these are the foundations on which the Islamic society was going to be built. Now, what happened after that was, from the first year of Hijri to the second year of Hijri, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the permission to fight. أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. That the Muslims have been given permission to fight against, because they've been oppressed. So Allah gave them permission that they can fight. So what the Prophet ﷺ did was, the initial 2 years before the Battle of Badr, what happened was, the Muslims were not that strong that they can go and fight in Makkah. They were slowly building the nation. So what they used to do was, because remember, all their wealth, their wives were left behind, the wealth was left behind, everything that they owned was left behind in Makkah. And the Mushrikeen of Makkah had seized everything. Yeah? So the only way to get it back was, remember, if you look at the map, Medina comes north of Makkah. Do you know that? Medina comes at the top and Makkah comes at the bottom. The trade route for the Makkans was, they had to pass Medina to get to Syria and to trade. Yeah? So the Muslims were in a good position. The caravans of the Makkans had to always pass through or pass by Medina for trade. So initially what the Prophet ﷺ did, he used to send out groups of Sahabas to go and attack these caravans and to get money. It's their money, isn't it? To get as much money as they can back from them. The Prophet ﷺ, some battles he went on, and some battles he didn't go. He used to send Sahabas out. Now the Battle of Badr, how that happened was, which is, I will say, the defining battles, or one or two of them, so that we know exactly what happened. So there were battles, skirmishes happening, treaties being made with different groups of Arabs, of Jews. In this period, treaties were being made. And all this time, the Makkah people, the Quraysh people, were instigating the people in Medina, the hypocrites, and other tribes of Arab to rise up against the Muslims. So the Prophet ﷺ, what happened was, Abu Sufyan, who later on became a Muslim, he came with a caravan. And the Prophet ﷺ, at a place called Usheirah, he wanted to overtake this caravan. But what happened, they had passed before the Sahabas could reach them, they had passed and gone past. On the way back, this caravan was coming back. So the Prophet ﷺ knew that this caravan is going to be on the way back. So he sent two Sahabas, Talha ibn Ubaidullah and another Sahabi. He sent them out and he said, go and scout them and see where they are. Look out for them. See where they are. So they saw them coming. And they found out that this caravan got a lot of wealth in it, 50,000 dinars, and only 40 people are guarding it. So the Prophet said, you know what, this is an opportunity to gain a lot of wealth from them and to put the balance of power towards us, because economical power is also necessary. To have money to use to do things, it's also necessary. So this caravan was coming, and obviously the Quraysh knew, Abu Sufyan knew, that the Prophet ﷺ was after these caravans to take money back from them. So what he did was he sent someone forward to Mecca to warn the Quraysh. So this person rode fast to Mecca, and he got to the Kaaba and he cut his camel's ears and nose. I mean, he made a scene basically, and then he cut his, you know, ripped his shirt off, and then he started screaming that your caravan's been attacked. Yeah? So the Quraysh, they gathered, oh, our caravan's been attacked, so much money, wealth is gonna go. So they gathered an army and they head towards Medina. Badr is about an hour away from Medina. So they head out towards Medina. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously they didn't expect Quraysh to come from Mecca with a huge army. They were just going for that small caravan. So the Prophet said that whoever wants to come can come, whoever doesn't want to come don't need to come in the battle. It wasn't going to be a battle, it was just going to be a, you know, they were just going to go and overtake the caravan. So this is why a huge army didn't go. There were between 300 to 317 men of the Ansar, about 82 Ansar Muhajir that came from Mecca, and about 170 from Khazraj, one of the tribes of the Ansar, and about 60 from the Aus. So altogether about between 300 and 317 people, that's all it is. They only had two horses. Okay? They had 70 camels, which they took turns to ride. So they weren't equipped for battle, if you know what I'm trying to say. The Muslims, they went to take this small caravan, but they weren't equipped to actually fight with the kuffar that were coming, because they thought, we're just gonna go and fight with this small caravan. So the Prophet ﷺ headed out. Now Abu Sufyan, why he took another route, and they had passed the Muslims and they had gone. He took a route by the Red Sea and he passed, and he's gone to Mecca already. So now the Quraysh are coming. Abu Sufyan has escaped. After escaping, he sends a message to the Quraysh that, look, I've escaped, there's no need to come, you can go back. But Abu Jahl, you know, they were already fuming because the Prophet ﷺ had taken, in other skirmishes before that had happened, the Prophet ﷺ has taken some of their wealth. So now they said, we're not going to back down now. They had 1,300 people with them. So they said, we're not going to back down. We're going to go all the way to Mecca. And what we're going to do, we're going to go to Badr. We're going to stand there, stay there. We're going to party, drink, you know, and dine, and basically chill out how they chill out. Yeah? Have you seen the Arabs how they chill out? Big camels, roasted, spitting on the thingy. Yeah, so they were basically gonna, you know, wine and dine, as they say. They were gonna chill out for a bit, have a party, and go back. So what happened was, there were 1,300 initially when they came out, but some, there were different tribes. So one of the tribes, they said, no, we're gonna go back. So one of the tribes, they pulled out and they went back, about 300 of them. This tribe later became Muslim, but 300 of them, they moved out. So now the Quraysh had 1,000 people. So now the Quraysh were advancing and they were coming to Badr. The Muslims advanced and they were in a dilemma now. We're not prepared for a battle. So many people, the Prophet sent out a scout and he found out that there's so many people coming from there to battle, and they were well equipped, you know, 600 soldiers, so many horses, so many camels. They were basically equipped for war, and the Muslims were not equipped for war. So now the dilemma was that if the Muslims, they move back, what would happen? Think of it. These guys are coming with a big army, then come to Medina. So they're going to come to the base of Islam and they're going to start attacking there. So when the rest of the world or rest of the Arabs, they hear about this, remember the Jews are also in Medina. the hypocrites are in Medina. So if these guys come with a big army, and then internally there's also strife there, the Muslims' position was weak. So the Prophet said that, you know, he had decided, because Allah told him that you're going to get one of two victories going to happen. Either you're going to get the caravan, or you're going to face these guys. Yeah, and you're going to overwhelm these Qurayshis that are coming. So he asked, he convened a meeting, and he asked the Sahaba that, what shall we do? This is a dilemma. If you go back, then these guys will come and attack us in Medina. So shall we go forward? So Hazrat Abu Bakr stood up and said, yes, we are with you 100%, go. Hazrat Umar stood up and he said the same thing, we are with you 100%, go. Miqdad radiallahu ta'ala, he stood up and he said that, yes, we are with you 100%. We are not going to be like the people of Musa alayhi salam. Yeah, the Jews. We're not going to say that, اِذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ فَقَاتِلَا إِنَّا هَا هُنَا قَاعِدُونَ. That you and your Lord go and fight with them, we are sitting here. Yeah, this is what the Jews said to Musa alayhi salam. That we are sitting here, you and your Lord go and fight with them. Yeah, he said, we are going to say, اِذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ فَقَاتِلَا إِنَّا مَعَكُمَا مُقَاتِلُونَ. Now go, you and your Lord, and fight. We are with you, fighting. So the Prophet ﷺ heard these three Sahabis saying this. But they were only from the Muhajirun, from the people of Makkah that migrated with the Prophet ﷺ. He wanted to hear. So he said, أَشِيرُ عَلَيَّ أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ. The Prophet ﷺ said that, give me advice, O people. So he's sitting here. These three have already told him that go and fight. But what happened was, he wanted the Ansar. Because what happened, the treaty with the Ansar that the Prophet ﷺ had was that they are only going to protect the Prophet ﷺ in the territory of Medina, not outside Medina. So the Prophet ﷺ wanted to hear what the Ansar are going to say. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala, he stood up and said that, it seems like that you want us to speak. So the Prophet ﷺ said, I want you to speak. I want the Ansar to speak. Because the Muhajirun are, how many, 80 people? Most of them are the Ansar. So he started speaking. He said that if you told us to jump into the sea, none of us will remain behind, we'll jump into the sea. You go, what your Lord has said, our oath is with you until death. We're gonna follow you. It doesn't matter. So when the Prophet ﷺ heard this from the Ansar, from the Sa'd ibn Mu'az, and that they were also ready to fight, the Prophet ﷺ said, we'll go forward. So they went towards Badr. Hazrat Abu Bakr and the Prophet ﷺ, they met a Bedouin, an old Arab person. So they asked him that, because the Quraysh had already come and camped. So they asked him that, to find out news, what's happening with these people. Where are they camped? How many are they? So he goes, oh, I'm not going to tell you until you don't tell me who you are. So the Prophet said, I'll tell you who we are, but you have to tell us what you know first. So he told them about the Quraysh, where they camped and how many people are there, and he told them everything. So then the Prophet was leaving. He goes, ask, you promised that you're going to tell me that who you are. So the Prophet says, turned around and said, we are from water. Yeah? So the Bedouin got confused. He goes, what do you mean by water? Are you from the water of Iraq? You know, from a river. So the Prophet didn't tell him that I am the Prophet of Allah. He didn't dodge the question. He answered it truthfully, but he didn't answer it according to what the guy wanted to hear. So this is also something that we need to learn, that you have to be tricky sometimes to save yourself. Yeah. So the Prophet ﷺ went and he found out that this is the situation of these people. There are 1,000 warriors and they're ready to fight, and this person is there. So he came back to the Sahaba, and they advanced towards Badr, and they decided to camp somewhere. So initially the Prophet ﷺ camped somewhere at the outskirts where the wells began. So a Sahabi called Hubab radiallahu ta'ala, he said, ask the Prophet, has Allah told you to camp here, or is it from your own accord? So the Prophet says, no, this is from my own accord. So Hubab radiallahu ta'ala said, no, this is not a good place to camp. If Allah hasn't told you to camp here, don't camp here. We'll go forward at the end of the wells, and what we'll do is, we'll fill our well with, gather all the water, and the rest of the wells will destroy them. So this is what the Prophet did, and the Sahabas, they camped, And they were in control of the water. And the rest of the wells were destroyed. So the kuffar or the mushrikeen of Makkah, they didn't have access to water. Now you can imagine, people have been to Saudi, how hot it is. Remember, this was in Ramadan. Yeah, Ramadan is usually hot. So this was in Ramadan, it's boiling. They don't have access to water. And the Prophet ﷺ has access to water. So they come there, and then the 17th of Ramadan, the night of the 17th of Ramadan, the Prophet ﷺ, even though he was promised victory over these people, to such an extent that the Prophet ﷺ actually said that this person is going to die here, this person is going to die here, this person is going to die here. And after, when the battle took place, the Sahabas found the bodies of those people in the exact same places. So even though the Prophet ﷺ knew he's going to gain victory, what he did, he all night he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah give us victory, you know, and his humbleness, and to the extent that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu had to come and say, stop it, it's enough, you've been promised victory, don't, you know, you don't need to torture yourself anymore, come down, rest. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, on the day of Badr, the people, a little like a hut was built for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to stay there. Why? Because just in case the Muslim were to lose the battle, then the Prophet ﷺ was protected, and then he could go back to Medina for reinforcements and fight from there. Because obviously you don't want to lose your leader. That's the worst thing that can happen. If your leader is lost, then you're in trouble. So they protected the Prophet ﷺ, and the two armies faced each other. Now what used to happen in those days in the battles was that there used to be Halmi Mubaris. Is anyone coming out? So there's two armies fighting each other, and they used to come out, and the top fighters of each army used to come and, you know, fight with each other before the main battle started. So from the kuffar of Makkah, the disbelievers of Makkah, three leaders came: Utbah, Shaybah, and Walid. Yeah, Utbah, Shaybah, and Walid. From the Muslims, three Ansar, three helpers, people of Medina, they came out. So those three said, oh, we don't want these farmers coming to fight with us. We want our cousins, we want the Qurayshis to come and fight with us. So the Prophet said, these Ansar, they move back, and the Prophet sent three people, Hazrat Ali, Hazrat Ubaidah, and Hazrat Hamza. Yeah? Now, it's, you know, Islamically, you have to pick good names, you know that, don't you? Everyone knows that, yeah? Yeah? Someone once came to me and they said, I've kept a good name for my child. I said, what have you called him? They have called him Rajim. You know what Rajim means? A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Rajim is basically a quality of shaitan. The kicked out, ejected. So because he's in the Quran, then Rajim will keep his name. So you have to keep good names. Yeah, another name comes to mind. They called him La Raib. His name is La Raib. Why is it La Raib? Because it's come in the Quran. So Shaitan also comes in the Quran. So keep your name Shaitan as well. So it doesn't work like that. It doesn't mean just because it's in the Quran, it's going to be a good name. Yeah? You have to think of the names before you keep them. It has to have a good meaning. That's why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so many times, he changed the name of people. Yeah? Okay, I'll leave it. I won't. Off the point. So what happened was, Utbah, Shaybah, and Walid. Utbah, you know what itab means? To be scorned. Yeah? Someone who's been blamed. So one of the kuffar was called Utbah, a blamed guy. Yeah? Second guy was called Shaybah. Shaybah means Buddha, an old guy. Yeah? So one guy who's blamed came out to fight by his name, and the other one, an old guy. So old people are not very strong, are they? So Shaybah came. Have you heard the Qasidah Burda? In the Burda, it says, "Ashaybu ab'adu fi nushim minat tuhami." That once your old age comes, the white hairs start coming. Yeah. There is no, what can I say, doubt that he's giving you good advice. Yeah? once you start getting old and you start getting weak, yeah, you should know by that time that I'm going to die soon. So ashaybu ab'adu fi nushim min at-tuhamin, giving advice, sincere advice. Once you start getting old, you need to take that into account, that I'm getting white hairs now, I need to change my ways. I've had my life now. The normal cycle is when you get older, you're going to die. The reality is, even when you're young, you don't know what's going to happen. You could die anytime. You see so many people dying at young age. So, ashaybu abadu fi nushamina tuhami, also give very good advice when you're old, but we shouldn't wait until we're old to take heed, because we don't know when we're going to die. So Shayba, and the other one was called Walid. Walid means a small boy. So a blamed person, an old guy, by the names basically, and a Walid, a small bacha, a small kid, came to fight with these guys. They were the leaders in Quraysh, but the names weren't right. On the other hand, we had Ali. Ali comes from Ulu. It means to be great, to be honorable. Yeah? Then you had Hamza. Hamza, anyone know what Hamza means? Asadullah. Yeah? Hamza means lion. So there's a lion and there's a big, strong guy. And Ubaidah means servant. So what happened was, look how things happen. How Allah plans things to the point where even the names were planned by Allah, that these guys, Utbah, Shayba and Walid, they're going to get destroyed. And Ulu, Ali, he came and killed, I think it was Shayba. He killed Shayba. Hazrat Hamza killed Walid. I can't remember exact way it's around, right? But Hazrat Hamza and Hazrat Ali, they knocked off their opponent straight away. Ubaidah, obviously his name wasn't that thingy, he got injured, and then Hazrat Hamza came and killed killed Utbah. So initially, this confrontation took place, and the Muslims, and a few more confrontations took place like this, but the Muslims were getting the upper hand. Now we can imagine there were 300 Muslims, 313, which is the most common figure, and there's about 1,000 kuffar. So their fighting begun. In the fighting, we all know what happened, that the kuffar were, you know, destroyed. They had to go back. Even Abu Jahl, the leader that came, that wanted to dance and party, the biggest leader of the kuffar, he was also killed. Now the point is, I'm not going to go into details too much of the battle, but the point is that the Muslims had gained a victory. Now this victory sent shockwaves around the Arabian Peninsula, that the Muslims had become strong. 1,000 people fought with about 300 people, and they lost and they went. For the Muslims were victorious, and this changed the position of the Muslims. They had become more stronger, more powerful. The next year, the Muslims were put back to their position. When the Battle of Uhud happened, it was opposite. The Muslims were very well prepared for the Battle of Uhud. But then what happened? They lost. They were defeated. Why? Because they did not listen to the Prophet ﷺ. If you know the Battle of Uhud, the Prophet ﷺ told the archers to stay in a certain position regardless if the Muslims are winning or losing. But some of the Sahabas, they said, no, we're winning, so we'll go down. He didn't mean it like that. So they went down and they disobeyed the Prophet's word. And this caused the Muslims to lose in the hands of Khalid bin Walid. You know, the Khalid bin Walid, he came around. So in one battle, the Muslims with less people, but Allah on their side, with the angels coming down, 1,000 angels came down to help the Muslims. They won the battle. On the other hand, the Muslims felt they were strong there, and they lost their battle. Because why? They did not listen to Allah and His Rasul fully, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So from this we understand that our strength as Muslims comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and listening to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? As soon as we leave sinning and become good people, then Allah will make us elevated and high. But in the position that we are in the position that we are in that you see nowadays. It's not going to change until we don't change ourselves. That's bottom line. So after the Battle of Uhud, many other battles took place. But I will say, in the 6th year of Hijri, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw a dream. I'm skipping all this because we don't have time. He saw a dream that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw himself performing Umrah. So the Sahabas went out to perform Umrah. They were stopped by the Mushrikeen of Makkah, displeased of Makkah. And then what happened was, they made a treaty, Sulah Hudaybiyah, in the 6th year of Hijri. Allah describes this treaty as, Inna fatahana laka fatham mubina. It's an open victory. The Muslims are saying, oh no, we're being oppressed here, you know, we haven't been, we couldn't go to Makkah, and we're coming down to them, and we're making a treaty with them. But the fact is, because of the Sulah Hudaybiyah, the Muslims, there were treaty between the Kuffar and the Muslims that no fighting is going to happen, and we're going to be in peace. So what happened was, the Muslims could propagate Islam freely. So people could come and join Islam a lot quicker and a lot easier. So even the Sahaba saw that, oh no, we're coming down. The reality is, it was a great victory for the Muslims, the Sulah Hudaybiyah. After that, Khaybar, I told you, where all the Yahud were kicked out of the Jaziratul Arab because of their treachery. Then the 8th year, the Fath Makkah, the conquering of Makkah, why did that happen? Also because the Quraysh, they broke their treaty. What happened was, the Muslims had some allies and the Quraysh had some allies. The allies of the Quraysh attacked the allies of the Muslims, and the Quraysh helped them. So because of that, the treaty was, no, you cannot attack our allies as well. But they did. So they broke the treaty. After breaking the treaty, they realized it's a big grave mistake we made. So Abu Sufyan came from Makkah and tried to sort it out, renew the treaty and all this, but the Prophet was not saying, he wasn't going to do it. So the Muslim army, they then marched to Makkah, and Makkah was conquered. Hardly anything happened in Makkah, was conquered. There was no bloodshed or anything. They just went, walked in, and they conquered Makkah. After the conquest of Makkah, imagine, the Prophet says, within 8 years from Hijrat, Prophet has gone to Makkah and he has conquered Makkah. Now the time for the Prophet had almost finished. He had built his nation. He had conquered Makkah, but he didn't move back to Makkah. He conquered Makkah. 3 years after that, the 11th year of Hijri, the Prophet ﷺ passed away. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجَهِ فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. These verses, when they came, Hazrat Abu Bakr knew that this was the sign for the death of the Prophet ﷺ. When the people started entering into Islam in big groups, all the Arabs started entering. There's hardly anyone that was non-Muslim there left. Everything was gone. So this is the time that the Prophet ﷺ was going to pass away. So on the 11th year of Hijri, after conquering Makkah, after so many battles in between, when the foundation of the Islamic State was laid, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum were prepared. We had Abu Bakr, Umar, big Sahabas. They were prepared enough to take the Islamic message forward. And this is why we see, after the Prophet ﷺ, Islam in the time of Hazrat Umar spread very rapidly. So there are many lessons that we can learn from the lifestyle of the Prophet ﷺ and in Medina. But the main message that I want to give today is unity. If we are united, then we are strong. If we are disunited, then we are weak. So hope everyone has understood in brief how the Medina period was. Obviously, this is not enough time to explain it in detail. But in brief, it was an 11-year period, and it consisted of a lot of battles. It consisted of making relations with people outside, sending messages to different leaders, you know, the leaders of Rome and Abyssinia, and trying to bring them towards Islam. So this is what the Prophet ﷺ did within how many years? Think of it, 23 years, and he built a nation that were tribal, who had no restrictions in what they did, to such a great nation that they spread halfway around the world.